Good morning, I'm Roland Martin. Next on News One Now, President Obama speaks out about Equal Pay Day. We'll hear from him and also talk about solutions for women to be paid the same as any man performing the same job. That may be proof Chicago cops are slacking on the job just because folks wanted to protest the Laquan McDonald shooting. We break down a shocking new report. Isn't it time for these cops to do the job they're being paid to do? Erica Badu has sparked outrage in the social media world when she tweeted about school uniforms. Folks are mad at her for saying wear skirts that are lower. We'll break it down with our panel as well. Also, Wendell Pierce and I sit down and talk about his dynamic role as Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas in the upcoming HBO film Confirmation. Also, we'll talk about the mentoring program 4-H and what it means for America's youth. It's time to bring the funk on News One Now on TV One. Equal Pay Day was celebrated yesterday around the country. April 12th marks the day that most women would have to work up to just to earn the same salary as men. Nationally, the average pay for a woman is $39,621 compared to a man's average pay of $50,383. That means in the U.S., women are paid 79 cents for every dollar a man makes. But it's even worse for women of color. African-American women make 60 cents to the dollar, while Latinas make only 55 cents to every dollar paid to a white male. To mark today, President Obama spoke at a historic Washington, D.C. home that was central to the women's rights movement, dedicating the Belmont Paul Women's Equality National Monument.
Equal pay for equal work should be a fundamental principle of our economy. It's the idea that whether you're a high school teacher, a business executive, or a professional soccer player or tennis player, your work should be equally valued and rewarded, whether you are a man or a woman. It's a simple ideal. I want young girls and boys to come here 10, 20, 100 years from now to know that women fought for equality. It was not just given to them. I want them to come here and be astonished that there was ever a time when women could not vote. I want them to be astonished that there was ever a time when women earned less than men for doing the same work.
So the real question is, how can this actually be changed? We're going to talk about that right now with several folks here. Also, folks understand there are a number of tech companies that also are looking to close the gap. Folks like Facebook, Microsoft, Apple, Intel, and Google. These companies are examples of how we can actually eliminate the gender wage gap. Also, though, what you also have is the Wall Street Journal. They were busted a few weeks ago because when a report was released showing the pay there, it showed that minority women there were actually making far less than anybody else. After being outed, then all of a sudden they said they will aggressively work to fix the problem, as if they didn't realize that was the case before. Here to discuss solutions, Congresswoman from Alabama, Congresswoman Terri Sewell, also on the panel. Dr. Avis Jones-DeWeaver, author of the book, How Black Women Lead. Davon Love, Director of Research and Public Policy for Leaders of a Beautiful Struggle. Barbara Arnwine, the founding president for the Transformative Justice Coalition. Sher Michael Singleton, a Republican political consultant. So folks, all welcome. I make this point again because you can talk about the problem. You can talk about, well, here's what it is, but how do you actually fix it? How do you actually get companies to make those decisions? Because they're making independent decisions. It's hard to track the information to know exactly what they're paying folks in the workplace.
Well, I know that we in Congress can do something about it in the sense that we can at least level the playing field through through laws and policies. For example, the Lilly Ledbetter Act, which was enacted, I think it was the first piece of legislation that President Obama enacted, actually allowed women to have the opportunity to sue companies for disparities in pay that they couldn't have done otherwise. I mean, Lilly Ledbetter went all the way to the Supreme Court, and ultimately they kicked her out and said that she should have known that the discrimination existed 20 years prior, and that's just ridiculous. So now I think that the thing before us now is the Paycheck Fairness Act, and so that will help to make things right with the Equal Pay Act. And so I think that there are policies that we can implement that will send a strong signal and really force companies to look at their wage disparities.
I know of one woman. She applied for a job, and it was with a church, and she was single. And they literally said that the reason the guy who she was replacing, the reason that he was paid more than her, was because he had a family, and his wife didn't work.
We hear it all the time, and it's just absolutely discriminatory. One of the other things that needs to be done, I mean, this do-nothing Congress that unfortunately you have to deal with every day, so sad, but we have been pushing for the Paycheck Fairness Act, but we also want more money to the enforcement agencies.
Yes.
Because part of the fight here is to make sure that the enforcement agencies are out there investigating these companies, reviewing their data, looking for these disparities, and holding these companies accountable. That's a huge part of this fight. Think about it. Black women in our working lifetime will lose $746,000 on an average in our lifetime of pay, $18,000 plus a year. On an average, that is just unconscionable when we see the tragedy and the economic circumstances that black women are suffering from. So it is absolutely necessary for us to really push this to the top of the agenda and to really seek and ask for very affirmative and powerful policies.
Because we know that when women succeed, America succeeds.
Thank you.
In the sense that we women oftentimes are a single head of households.
Exactly.
And so when we increase the pay for women, we really are uplifting the family.
We saw a couple of years ago where the president signed an executive order that required government contractors to actually pull open the books so they could actually see what people are paid by race and gender. And I think it's very important to make that distinction because yesterday was not my equal pay day. For black women, our equal pay day doesn't come until August, towards the end of August, August 23rd. So let's keep it real.
That's
Even
right.
though we are...
First of all, explain to anybody who's watching why you say August 23rd.
Yes. Because that's how long a black woman has to work into 2016 to make on par what white men earn in 2015.
Exactly.
That's how much further we have to work
so
into the new year.
April 12th is white women's equal pay.
That's correct.
Yeah, it's the overall.
She's correct.
And if you look at, for example, the data that you just mentioned about 60 cents to the dollar, that's 60 cents to the dollar when compared to white men. When compared to white women, now, white women, we make only 77 cents to the dollar. Mm-hmm. So there is both a race and a gendered aspect to this.
Yes.
So pulling back the cover so that we can actually see how people are paid across both race and gender is extremely critical. Just sort of leveling the playing field by gender really does not really do everything that needs to be done in terms of making sure that people are paid fairly.
Devon, it's very interesting because while the Obama administration has been talking about this and congressional leaders, there have been reports showing that there's a wage disparity among women working in the White House and women on Capitol Hill.
That's correct.
And you know, I mean, two things. One of the things that's interesting is that I've been disappointed at the fact that mainstream conversations about equal pay don't include the conversation about black women being paid less than white women, right? And that many of the organizations
because they don't want to, just like you will never hear any discussion about affirmative action that white women have benefited more
been
from affirmative action than anybody else.
Absolutely. And so I think that's important. I think the other piece, too, is that oftentimes the indices that we use to determine our financial situation is usually done by income. Mm-hmm. But I think it's also to think about it in terms of wealth. There's a statistic out there that says that on average, the wealth that black women have in this country is $5, right? And so if you think about actually a sustainable solution to addressing the issue of black women and equal pay, we just start talking about shifting wealth and strategies towards investing in our community's ability to garner wealth so that we're not relying on companies to have to actually pay folks equally. And that's not to say we shouldn't have the enforcement mechanisms of companies, but that's another part of the strategy that I think is sustainable.
Shermichael, real quick.
I just think it's very important that we pay people based upon their experience, based upon what they bring to the table. I can't see how any corporation could justify paying a person more or less based upon their gender. I also think
because typically it's a white man who's doing the hiring.
Well, I also think that the president needs to lead by example and make sure that people within his White House, I think Congress needs to lead by example also to make sure that women are making more. And as it pertains to African-American women, I think putting more money in their pockets gives them the ability to make sure that their kids are able to enroll in summer programs,
right,
buy the necessary resources that those kids may need to be successful.
You talk about leading. Let's talk about this next story. Chicago may be the latest city dealing with the so-called Ferguson effect, an idea that suggests the city's crime rate increases as police officers turn their backs to violent crime cases. Those officers usually upset because people are ticked off. They've done something stupid. Well, November 24, 2015, authorities released the dash cam video of the Laquan McDonald shooting. As a result, you've seen all sort of studies showing that in Chicago, there's been a 48% increase in shootings there also. But guess what? A 48% decrease in arrests. What in the world is going on in Chicago? And so we want to talk about that right now. The folks at 538, a website, they have been actually looking at this, breaking down these numbers. Let's go to it right now. Jeff Asher, he's out of New Orleans, a crime analyst and a contributor to 538. Jeff, I got the impression that cops in Chicago don't want to lead because they're now scared to death of being busted, caught on video.
Well, we were very careful in the report not to necessarily point out any causation. So it's difficult to say from the data whether what the actual cause of the slowdown or what actually caused the change in both the gun violence increasing and the arrest rates for homicides, non-fatal shootings, and proactivity to go down.
Well, here's the deal, Jeff. It's not like they fired a bunch of police officers. It's not like a bunch of them retired. So you still have the same number of people who are out there on the streets. And then when you actually hear anecdotal information from cops, oh, you know, they're scared of being caught on tape. Here's the reality: if you do your job, if you don't lie on a police report, if you don't say the guy came charging at you with a gun, when the video shows he didn't, if you don't go into a Burger King and erase the video, then guess what? Nobody's going to say you screwed up.
Absolutely. It's a very complex problem, and it's a problem that appears to not be getting better. One of the things, I just ran the numbers for this morning, there have been 546 non-fatal shootings this year in Chicago, and seven of them have ended in arrest. So I do agree.
Hold on. 546?
Non-fatal shootings
and only seven arrests.
Seven arrests as of April 4th. So, you know, it's a very complex problem. I think that it needs a solution. No matter what the problem is, it is a completely untenable problem for both the Chicago Police Department and absolutely for the people of Chicago that are suffering under this gun violence epidemic.
Well, I saw this tweet from the guy who's actually a sports blogger, Clay Travis, and others who said, well, you know, there you go, Black Lives Matter. You're leading to other black people getting shot and killed because of your protests, as if folks should not be protesting, crazy cops out of control.
One of the things that we were able to do, and this is something that with all of the discussion of what's causing the increased gun violence in Chicago over the first quarter of 2016 focused on what they've been calling the sort of ACLU effect of the additional paperwork that was thrust onto the police department in the wake of the video coming out. And I think what our contribution is and what we were able to show is that everything started late November, early December. And so the comment that we reported that has been talked about in the Chicago press and throughout Chicago is this stay fetal reaction of Chicago Police Department. And everything started right after the video. And so it's hard to necessarily blame the protests. It's because the reaction was
right,
so swift. And it does, I mean, and honestly, you know, just speaking from not necessarily being able to back this up with the data, but I think that the most compelling argument is that the police department, not through an organized slowdown, but through this natural reaction of fear and uncertainty, started or stopped doing the police work that is so important. And
right,
you see that throughout the numbers. And if you're not solving non-fatal shootings, it's going to remove the deterrent effect that could potentially drive down shootings and homicides. And so if the only shootings that you're even trying to solve are fatal shootings, then you're going to have a spiraling out of control gun violence. And I think that's what the data shows is happening.
Gotcha. All right, then, Jeff, we appreciate it. Thank you so very much. Panel, real quick before I got to go to a break, it's clear these cops don't want to do their job,
and they're
purposely slowing down and say, we're not going to do anything. We'll let folks just go crazy.
Yeah, they're punishing the community.
Right.
This is a backlash, and it is organized. I mean, I don't see how anyone can be, want to conjecture one thing and conjecture something else. I will gladly conjecture that this is organized slowdown because we're seeing it across multiple cities after similar occurrences where cops are caught on tape actually killing people without cause.
And this is a corrupt police department. We still haven't had any accountability for the black site where they arrested and, well, they didn't even formally arrest, just held and detained 7,000 black men. Never have anyone been held accountable for this. This is a corrupt police department. It cannot try to hide behind some kind of excuse as long as it keeps on operating the way it does. This police department needs to be cleaned up from
absolutely.
Bottom to top.
And again, bottom line is it's also leadership. That's why I also say you can't hire a superintendent from on the inside because
right.
It's part of the culture.
Thank you.
Folks, coming up, we'll talk about Erykah Badu sparking social media frenzy when it comes to what young girls should be wearing in school. Also, actor and activist Wendell Pierce breaks down playing Justice Clarence Thomas on HBO's movie Confirmation. All that next on News 1 Now on TV One.